Meanderings?
Yes.
Meanderings.
Katrina replacements.
I don't feel like
sadness. It's okay. We'll fix it.
It'll look like one.
Next week I'll be back for some of those Justice League trades as soon as I can figure out which ones.
Well, it's easy peasy because now you know we have
it. Yep. Supporting my local.
All right. 37-43. The sad thing is, I don't know what happened to the pen. So now we get to sign with our fingers again.
Great.
Super great.
Are we actually making a transaction from this?
We are. Because it happens all the time.
Too fast for the thing.
Well, I put a happy heart over my eye today.
I don't mean to tell you anything bad, Tex, but that was terrible.
Hey, it doesn't look much better with the pen.
It looked like my name. It was awesome.
You like Trigun, right?
Rethinks. Yes, I do.
Okay.
Thank you.
Very
There's
well.
The Trigun movie coming out from the original creators. Trigun Badlands Rumble.
Live action or anime?
Anime.
That's
okay.
What I asked them.
Yeah, everybody's like...
Because they'll get Keanu Reeves for it like they're going to do for Cowboy Bebop.
Wait, what?
What?
Unless they finally drop that project.
Please?
We're all like, what?
It can't be Spike Spiegel.
No, it can't be.
Yeah, well, that was the original plan. Dude, this has been the pipeline for a while. Hopefully he's wooed himself out of the project.
Hopefully they watched Constantine and were like, yeah, on second thought, no.
Yeah, after 5 minutes of constipated, that would have been the end of his being Spike Spiegel right there. Has he done anything since then?
What, Constantine?
After Constantine. That's like
he did The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Yeah, but that was crap.
Don't hate, it came with the original movie in the DVD.
You could get the original movie by itself, so
yeah.
It wasn't contaminated then.
Oh, I like that. Excellent.
I did it anyway because it was Blu-ray.
Of course you did.
They don't reprint the old stuff on Blu-ray, okay?
Flashback to 30 years ago. It's crap, but...
D-bag.
You were already born then. You missed out on this.
Hey, I still have my VHS player, okay? And I got my artillery box full of VHS.
I don't have any more
VHS. The magnetic is just being stripped off of them right now.
Shut up. Don't be like that.
Hey, I still have a few DVD-Rs that survived Katrina, stuff I was able to transfer that will never be on DVD. So.
Such as?
Oh, a bunch of stuff. Remember Wizard of Speed and Time? Look it up online and see it. It's awesome.
I thought that about Howard the Duck, and they put it on DVD.
Right? It was never on DVD for like so long, then they finally dumped
they
it out.
They did put it out on DVD?
Yeah, it's on DVD.
I paid full price.
Yeah. Mercy and French mean thank you.
It is on one of the top 15 worst movies ever made.
There's a reason for that.
But it was PG and it had duck boobs in it.
Yeah.
What?
It did.
There were duck tits.
The first 10 minutes. It's like, oh no, he's blowing through someone else's apartment. Doesn't cover anything. It's great. It's PG.
Feathery
it's,
duck
it's
tits.
It's 80s PG.
I know.
It's different than nowadays.
It's a different grade.
I'm going to have to buy it just for duck tits.
I'll let you borrow it just for
Watch
duck tits.
Watch Goonies again. They cuss like crazy in that.
And what was that, G?
I'm waiting for the Goonies reboot. Excuse me, reimagining.
It's okay. It
won't
be terrible.
It's bad enough to begin with.
There's going to be two really awesome books.
Remember, the Goonies, Buttboy Spielberg, destroyed the original Shaolin Temple set from Kung Fu just to film some scene from Goonies.
Hey, it's okay. It was for Goonies. Goonies is way better.
Goonies forever.
Saw it in 98, was not impressed.
Wait, Goonies was made in 98?
No, that's when I saw it. I was forced at gunpoint to see it.
Gunpoint?
Yeah, well,
what
it was a couple of my chicks,
gunpoint?
So I had no choice.
Was it a Ruger?
Yeah, because you would have survived that.
Now they're women. They kill in more deadly, subtle ways.
And slowly.
Very slowly. No, but
yeah,
I was going afterward, they were asking me what I thought. It's like, that was it?
Ooh!
That's
word.
What you made
there
so much fuss about?
The truffle shuffle.
Stupid fat kid. Spielberg's boy obsessions he brought over from Indiana.
I figured out a nickname for it. So.
Sadness.
watching it was creepy as hell because Spielberg
wants to lose all the captions.
This is not going to have audio. Okay. This is just going to be a video.
So these guys show up.
Good. I wouldn't care.
He's too good for him.
See ya, man. Tell him this as I said, hey.
We cool text. Make good choices.
Why?
He didn't say no.
I did.
Yeah, but.
We need to get a shot. That says Portal to
the Black Panther ball in the game. Hell yeah, there is. Everything, okay? That's what.
They slay gods. I guess that's it. I don't know. And half-clad women. So real, the game transcends reality.
Don't think it actually does.
It.
Hence why it's a game.
Believe it. That's a photo of a McFarlane Toys action figure. So why is the game transcend reality if it's a figure?
I guess because it's McFarlane who did it. Probably. Maybe.
That's the thing, I know what he paid for.
Grant, I thought you weren't going to be here till later.
Yes, it's in his way. That's
later with Scott.
That's a friend of here.
That's how many I'm waiting on.
They were precious. They did a kind of a week like bringing it back. No, not a reimagining or telling, just like a picking up with X-Babies.
Oh.
And they were the, basically they were the, I think team up, and they were the other good guys, and they were fighting. Like, oh, all right, we should team up and go do this, and they did.
We just got back some from BK, the All-Star Superman kit.
Well, you finally, that's what, been a year and a half?
I thought they were yours.
No, that's what you said last time. You said,
you'd be surprised.
They got someone in there.
Oh, damn. I got the first issue, but it's like.
Didn't get all the other. I have two issues over here.
Oh, one of the. I don't know if it's any of the ones you ordered, but have you checked out these Flash books yet?
God.
Thank you.
What?
The dude in the dude with the tats was.
Then you have to be out in the parking lot with that guy.
Oh, yeah.
If you can, I got a cooler shirt.
Hey, Brian, I was here.
A little bit.
That's what she said.
Oh.
Ah.
Oh, jeez.
She thinks we're just fishing.
I did. Like way earlier.
What is this?
Oh, yeah, for Kid Flash.
Oh, that's the one? Is that...
It was either for Kid Flash or Professor Zoom.
No, Zoom has a black one. I was wishing we had one of that because that looks pretty badass, actually.
There I am.
Is it black?
Yeah, that's right. You'll pay attention.
Okay, you ready?
Ready?
Mm-hmm. Keep it down, please.
Quiet on the set.
Alright, so briefly introduce yourself. What got you started? How long have you been doing this? What do you do?
My name is Brian King. I'm an illustrator. Unlike a lot of illustrators that have that definitive moment where they decide that they're going to go into comics or cartoons or video games, I never had that. I've always drawn, and when I was younger, I thought that was just the way it was. People drew, and they were artists. I guess sometime in there, I realized not everybody obsesses over this like I do. I started out being self-taught, and I thought, well, you know, taking some classes on and aren't going to hurt. So I ended up getting my bachelor's in fine art with an emphasis in graphics, secondary in sculpture, a minor in art history, and I went on to get my master's in art education. So that's kind of how I got started, is just never knowing that everybody in the world did this.
What other interests do you have? You play role-playing games, you play, you know, science fiction, you like science fiction or anything?
Okay, growing up, a lot of people, since I'm primarily a comic book artist, people think that, you know, that's what I did growing up, is read comic books and draw. And although I did enjoy looking at them mainly to learn how to draw, my first love was role-playing games and fantasy. I read the Lord of the Rings trilogy the first time in elementary school, read it again in high school, then read it again in college, and there was always something new that it gave me. And I remember playing Dungeons and Dragons and looking at Larry Elmore's artwork and being amazed. And I would try, I didn't like copying art. I've never enjoyed looking at something and trying to recreate it, but I would look at Larry's dragons and try and draw them in different scenarios at different angles. And I think that really helped out a lot. And funny story about that, I was in New Orleans doing signings for one of my books, and it was Sunday, it was early in the morning, and I was barely awake, and we did a panel room, and the panel's when you get up in front of a bunch of people and you talk to them about art or literature or whatever subject that they want you to cover. And so I sat down, and there was this nice older gentleman next to me, and he says, "Hey, my name's Larry." Well, it didn't click who this gentleman was until about halfway through. We're taking questions, and I'm getting along with this guy, Larry, who I had no idea who he was, when someone finally asked him what it was like working for TSR, who, of course, back then put out Dungeons and Dragons. And it was funny because I sprawled when I realized this is Larry Elmore, and that was our first meeting, so that was kind of a cool thing, seeing that whole fantasy world, there was a face behind all this amazing artwork. And then that's how I got into it.
Explain a little bit about your cookbook and your drawing. What's that?
Okay, this is the Kingly Adventures cookbook. My wife and I actually produced this. I'll show you some of the pictures. I wanted to find an area that not many people had covered in fantasy, and I've always enjoyed cooking, so what we did was we created a cookbook that features mythological creatures. And so if you can't find, let's say, a kraken, you can substitute squid. If you can't find a minotaur, then a nice cut of beef will do. And so this is what we've been promoting lately, the Kingly Adventures cookbook, and we're actually going to be online with a little TV show by the end of the summer, where we have different, not only comic book artists, but fantasy artists in general and writers come on and cook with us. So that's what we're doing with this.
Okay.
So what negative stereotypes have you ever had, heard of, or been accused of about role players and dungeon and people like Dungeons & Dragons and sci-fi and fantasy and such?
Well, I remember getting into Dungeons & Dragons in the mid to late 80s, and it was funny because the first time my parents saw me with the Dungeons & Dragons book, I think it was the Player's Handbook, they freaked out, and they were like, you know, I've heard things about this in stories, and, you know, people go too far, and it turns you to the occult. And I'm thinking, you know, we're basically about chips, Mountain Dew, and having fun with your friends. You know, I was raised Catholic. I went to school every Sunday, and I couldn't wrap my mind around my parents thinking that I would actually get into something that was evil or satanic. And geeky may be a little bit nerdy, but a lot of fun, and definitely not a negative influence in my life. And the only time I even questioned myself, I remember in high school, we got into the live-action role-playing, which is also a lot of fun and a positive thing. But there was one point when we were in the ditch and fighting with swords. I thought, you know, we're this close to going too far. But it turns out that wasn't true. We did the live-action role-playing for years. Nobody got hurt, and we had a really good time. And it kept us out of trouble.
So what positive effects do you think people get when they play Dungeons & Dragons or like comics or fantasy or sci-fi?
Well, I think comic, sci-fi, role-playing in general helps people to become a more creative thinker. You think outside of the box. They've done a lot of studies that have been kind of interesting. They say that people grew up playing mainly video games, which I think it's a fairly similar kind of thing. They're more creative thinkers, but their attention span is a little bit lessened. And I think it's because someone with a creative mind that is into fantasy, they can process information so fast. And so it's easy to get bored.
Okay. Thank you, Brian.
All right, thank you. Let me get a couple more shots here.
Okay. You want to do static or you want me drawing while you do
that?
Yeah,
drawing. Give me a second to get on there.
Card for your head, man?
A card?
Yeah, just a call us if you have any questions.
Oh, sure.
More than happy to answer. You got the hours on the door. You got a pin on.
Yeah.
I'm sure you talked to the guy.
Just flip through it a couple of times, just like you were talking before.
Yeah, Dino.
Dino Grimlock.
Dino Box.
Yeah.
Dino Box, that's correct.
Isn't that also Grimlock?
No, that is only a Fortress Masters.
I don't know.
Well, she's called the director of Hitler.
Oh,
that's
cool. She's a cunt.
Yeah, she's a cunt.
You've been a devil worshiper.
I have been worshiping Satan for the past 17 years. It's one of those religions that you really have to get out of soon if you're not completely dedicated to the Dark Lord, because slaughtering, it takes a toll on you. And if you believe in the whole Christianity thing, silly, you really want to worry about the parts of your soul that might miss, that will go away, if you continue, you know, killing barnyard animals so as to call upon said Dark Lord. Because it takes a lot. It takes a lot for him to get back at you. I mean, think for every time that you call him, it has to be threefold the amount of blood you used last time. So you have to take really careful consideration of what you've used before. You got to chart it all out. It's much like D&D with the graphs. You shouldn't have put me down in the kitchen. You shouldn't have put me in the kitchen.
No, hilarious.
Okay. So what's
all right, you ready?
Yeah, let's hear it.
I hope you got that.
Oh yeah.
Epic.
Okay. Alright. Introduce yourself and what you do and your title here and everything.
Well, my name is Anthony Eakes. I work for Three Alarm Comics, which is awesome. We play host to guys like Mitch Bird and Stephen King. Brian King, thank you. But anyway, 5 seconds.
You want to start up?
Yeah.
Okay.
So my name is Anthony Eakes. I work for Three Alarm Comics. We play host to guys like Brian King and Mitch Bird, and we're generally awesome. I myself help run the register. I help take care of the inventory. We help file back issues, take new issues off the new shelf, put them on the 3-month shelf, and off the 3-month shelf into the back issues, etc. There's a lot of stuff. I clean too. I'm personally into science fiction, comics. I like console gaming, but I'm not so big into the whole RPGs, that sort of thing.
So how long you been doing this?
This here?
Into comic books and everything.
Oh, into comic books. It's been forever. You never get out.
Okay. So what negative stereotype do you think are around people who like comics and sci-fi and fantasy and such?
You don't get girls. That's one. That's the big one. That's the important one. You're bad at social situations. In general, you're not good at life, which about 75% of that's true. It's not inaccurate anyway. Other than that, nothing that I've personally experienced.
Have you ever heard this, the old stereotype that people who like Dungeons & Dragons are Satanists or cultists?
I've heard tell of it. It's been a more recent thing, though. I haven't heard it when I first heard of D&D and all that.
Yeah. Do you think it's accurate?
I wouldn't say as much. I would say there's a vein of fans that could very well be into that, but on the large, no.
Okay. So when people like sci-fi comics and everything, what are some of the benefits and stuff they learn from it or get out of it?
Well, your vocabulary grows exponentially. Big word. No, but yeah, you get a better vocabulary. You get a better grasp of certain physics properties that you wouldn't normally be privy to because, you know, people don't fly. Aside from that, you learn great morals and testicular fortitude. You also gain a great appreciation of a decent story and great art, and the exact opposite of a bad story and terrible art. Stuff like that.
Right, cool. Do you think it also helps out with your creativity and imagination?
I personally think so, yes. My collection is a backlog. I like to use it for reference a lot.
Okay. All right, thank you, Anthony.
Not a problem. Pleasure as always. Do you need this?
Yes. Too fast?
Okay, for one thing, I'm gonna shy.
Okay.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
Do we find ourselves some goodies?
Yes.
Neat. All right. I got you at 37.44.
Mm-hmm.
Nifty. Not a 40. All right. 256 is your change. And thank you so much for coming and seeing us. Did you want a bag?
Thank you, please.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're very welcome, and thank you.
Have a nice day.
And to you as well.
Oh, I'm good.
Okay.
Okay.
Hey, this just means less I don't
have to work, and sooner I get to,
you know, go do the dance class thing.
Did you
get your monies? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. All right. Okay. Hey, introduce yourself, what you do, and how long you've been in the gaming, comic books, stuff like that.
Name's Scott Hoberman, and I'm the owner of Three Alarm Comics in Biloxi, Mississippi. Been doing this, the retail part, for a little over 20 years now. Been collecting and the whole aspect of it for probably since I was about 3 or 4 years old.
Okay. What got you into it originally?
My father actually collected before I did, and just kind of passed the love of the hobby on to me. And from there, it just grew into something more to where we are now. It just started off as just me buying and collecting to the point where I just had no more room left in the house for any more stuff. So we opened the store and we've kind of gone from there.
Okay. So what do you think are the benefits of you know, people who like fantasy and comic books and sci-fi and stuff?
Tend to be a little bit more imaginative, a little more free thinking. Open-mindedness is one of the biggest advantages I've seen most anybody that have frequented any type of shop or any type of sci-fi genre, fantasy genre. The artwork itself is just absolutely beautiful. You know, you can't find stuff that, you know, you can't find artwork like this anywhere else in any other industry. for the most part, I just think it basically brings a lot of people together for common interest. So,
speaking about specifically Dungeons & Dragons players and such, what are your negative stereotypes have you ever heard about people who play D&D and role-playing games and such?
Most of them can't get a life, can't get girls. You've heard little things about the satanic part of it here and there. I think that's just more of a, just personally, more of a thing about people just being too scared to actually do any research about it and just going by what somebody else says, and rather than trying to take responsibility themselves to actually get to find out about it.
And what do you think the future for comic books and the genre and sci-fi is?
Well, I've seen for comic books in particular, it seems more that things are going towards more the digital age, where downloading is being more and more prevalent. I'm kind of torn between the two, because I know a lot of people have that collector mentality, and in order to have the collector mentality, you have to have that in your hand, be able to have it to collect it. When you've got it on a hard drive and you're just pulling it up on your computer screen and there can be billions upon billions of copies of it, that kind of just lets go of that collector mentality of it.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Scott.
All right.
Sound all right?
Yeah. Okay. Good deal.
Whenever you're ready.
You ready?
Yes. Do you want to ask anything?
So do you think comics and other things are really still considered underground?
Not so much per se anymore. I mean, there's always the obvious ones, the X-Men, the Superman, the Batman, Daredevil, Silver Surfer, Fantastic Four. All the obvious ones are not so much underground, but the ones that used to be considered underground now are making big blockbuster movies, even as far back as The Crow, Sin City, 300 was actually a comic book, Hellboy. A lot of these small underground things were used to be underground, now have completely blown up into an industry all into itself.
So you think that comics are now, so you think that movies now are a major outlet for comic book characters and such?
Absolutely. It's all about licensing nowadays. They're taking characters that have been the love of people's lives for so long, and now they're getting to see them going from a printed piece of paper to coming to life on a big screen.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
This piece down here with the skull and everything he did, of course, it was pretty old. Let's see. This little cat and mouse thing up here, him and Steven both did. That little thing, a big snake-looking thing coming out, he did. There's more stuff on the other side, too.
And get closer to Daredevil and everything. Do you want to know? We'll go around you.
Friday night.
Okay.
He urinates into the reservoir. They empty the whole reservoir. 8 million gallons.
Mm-hmm. Because of that?
Yeah. This is a Portland process. All the time now. Oh, we had such a reaction.
Danver got his armor, Hogan has his.
Why industrial armor?
You can go away.
Because the serpent came back, and he's actually going to, it's a fortress base that they can actually stave off the serpent.
I'm not sure if I'm down with that.
It's going to be...
It's like $4 a head. I'm just trying to get him...
I think they normally charge like $5 anyway.
Yeah.
The lizard, so, and all the money goes to the...
Yeah, all money will go to him. I'm just trying to get him about.
Falling or what?
No, it was just, it was
I never knew he had this.